morning. This is a very special evening tonight, something a little different that I hope you love. I'd like to introduce my dear friend and colleague, Miss Ty Kimmerly. Even though I'm the one that's going to be on stage tonight, we have done an equal amount of work for this project. It is a joy to have a colleague to work with at Anderson Middle School. And between the two of us, we teach these 200 beautiful, amazing kids. Let's give them a round of applause, please. So I just want to tell you what you're in for tonight, and it's pretty special and amazing. I want to start by thanking the Berkley Choir Boosters for purchasing all the scripts for every child. These scripts are 60 pages long. They're an 8.5 by 11 page, so it's full of music and lines. This is an operetta that was written in the 1880s. It is pretty spectacular. It's called Pirates of Penzance. If any of you have seen the movie Pretty Woman, there's a great quote about the Pirates of Penzance. They go to a fancy opera. I believe it's La Boheme. I'm not totally sure. And they're in the box. They're in box seats, which are just filthy expensive. And there's this old couple. They look awfully formal. And they're sitting with the Richard Gere and Julia Roberts. And she loves the opera. She's never been. And she says, "It was so wonderful, I almost peed my pants." And the old lady said, "What?" And Richard Gere says, "She liked it more than Pirates of Penzance." So hopefully you will feel this, well, don't have an accident, but you will have a wonderful night with us tonight too. This is the fifth year in a row that Berkley School District has celebrated best community for music education, and that is something we're very proud of. Ty and I are only two of the cogs in that wheel. There are 11 of us, and we try very hard to try new things and to expose our students to lots of different amazing opportunities, this being one of them. We're a best community in music education largely because of the people sitting in front of me. You value the arts, you invest in our schools, you vote for our bonds, you come to our concerts, and you celebrate these amazing kids. So thank you. You know, we talk about the Berkley difference quite a bit. This is very real. This is a living thing. I went to Choral Festival in March. I went with these petunias, and all the directors kind of go in a room to get our scores, and we were talking about our school district, and I was talking with Mr. Jackson, who's our accompanist. He's working on an American premiere of a piece called A Walk in the Garden by Jonathan Dove. That's why he's not with us tonight. He's pretty fancy. And I was saying that my principal was in the audience. I was referring to Mr. Gowell, who came with the high school kids, and they were like, "Your principal's here? Our principal doesn't even know we go to competitions." I said, "Yeah, our principal's here, and my middle school principal, Mr. Ross, played the drums for us when we went to districts." And they went, "He played the drums? For your choir?" And after they were resuscitated, I said, "You know, I'm so lucky. We have such incredible support from our community, from our principals, from you." Another community member that's here with us tonight is Mystic Kettle. They are in the lobby at the end of the show, so if you would like a tasty treat on the way out, a bit of the proceeds go to us, so you get to have something yummy and we get to have more of your support, which we love very much. Tonight you're going to hear an operetta. An operetta is less singing than an opera, but more singing than a musical. So if this is the spectrum, an opera and musical, an operetta is right in the middle. Operettas are always in English, so don't worry. And they're always funny. So you're gonna enjoy this tonight. There's a lot of middle school humor to Gilbert and Sullivan, a lot of bathroom humor, a lot of silliness, a lot of misunderstandings and silly situations. It's a satire on Victorian England about politics, fashions, and society, but you don't need to know that to enjoy this show. If you would like, I could meet you for coffee. I have a book that's about this thick that explains the references. I would be more than happy to geek out with you and share them with you. I like lattes. The students behind me are amazing. They've learned this score in 4 weeks. 4 weeks. 4 weeks with M-step testing, 4 weeks with field trips, 4 weeks with all this craziness. They are amazing. Amazing. They're just, who passes out an opera written in 1880 to their kids and goes, yeah, let's do this? Me. And they, look at how fabulous they look. They are so ready for you. So I will speed this along. Gilbert and Sullivan are the two that wrote this operetta. They were complete opposites. One was tall, one was short, one was nice, one was mean. One liked to be around people, one didn't like to be around people. Complete opposites. And they disliked each other immensely, so much so that they were never together. They wrote 13 operettas together entirely by correspondence. So letters. I don't even know how that's possible. How someone can send a score and then someone can write the words and they come together only through written word is pretty amazing to me. They were wildly popular in the United States and in England. At one time in the late 1890s, when HMS Pinafore was first came onto the stage in both the United States and in England, every school-aged child could sing all of the songs. That's without iTunes, that's without YouTube. The popularity of Gilbert and Sullivan was immense. There has never been a Friday night since 1880 where a Gilbert and Sullivan show hasn't been performed somewhere in the world. That longevity is incredible. Since 1880, somewhere in the world, Gilbert and Sullivan is being staged on a Friday or Saturday night. Which leads me to think, when I look on YouTube, which one of these chuckleheads is gonna last that long? Who knows? Is it gonna be, will Michael Jackson last that long? Maybe. Elton John? Maybe. Lady Gaga? Who knows? This is an incredible legacy. There are over 2,000 Gilbert and societies in the world, the closest one being at U of M. It's called UMGAS, U-M-G-N-S, UMGAS. And they perform Gilbert and Sullivan shows all year long. I have thank yous before I turn it over to the kids. Thank you to my dear friend and colleague, Ty Kimmerly, who again is definitely a co-partner in this production. To Mr. Hopkins, our amazing auditorium manager and drama director. Ooh. To our administration, the central office, our school board, Mr. Ross, Mr. Cowdery, we are so blessed having a rich, thriving fine arts program. And to these glorious students behind me who have taken this challenge and have run with it, you're gonna see a lot of joy, a lot of silliness, and a lot of joy and silliness. They are open-minded, they bring passion, and I can't imagine waking up and having the pleasure of playing with anyone else all day. So, ladies and gentlemen, Pirates of Penzance.
Thank you. today our pirate prentice rises from a dangerous raid. Strong as arm and keen as scent as he's a pirate now. And alone he's fit to fly, which were bent on signalizing with unusual reverie.
Here's good luck to Frederick's Ventures, Frederick's out of his adventures. Pour upon the pirate, sherry, fill the pirate glass. And to make us more than merry, let the pirate longer pass.
Yes, Frederick. From today, you rank as a full member of our band.
Hurrah!
My friends, I thank you all. I wish I could repay you.
What do you mean?
Today, I am out of my indentures, and today, I leave you forever.
But why? There was never a better hand at hunting down and sinking ships as you.
Yes, I have done my best for you. And why? It was my duty, and I am a slave of duty. As a child, I was apprenticed to your band. It was a mistake, but no matter. This mistake was ours and not yours, and I was in honor bound by it.
A mistake? What mistake?
No, dear master. My mind has long been troubled by this mystery. I'll tell them at once. Oh, pardon, Frederick, pardon!
Right, sweet one, I pardoned you long ago.
Those two words were so much alike.
They were, and they still are, but today my obligation ends. Individually, I love you all, but as a group, I look on you with disgust. My beloved friends, because of my sense of duty, once I am free of you, I shall devote myself heart and soul to your extermination.
Poor lad! Poor lad!
Well, Frederick, if you really feel that it is your duty to destroy us, we cannot blame you for that. Always act according to your conscience, my boy.
Besides, we can offer you little temptation to stay with us. We don't seem to make piracy pay. I don't know why, but we don't.
I know why, but alas, I mustn't tell you.
Why not, my boy? You are one of us until the clock strikes 12.
True, and until then, you are bound to protect our interests.
Hear, hear!
Well then, it is my duty as a pirate to tell you that you are too tender-hearted. For instance, you make a point of never attacking a weaker party than yourselves, and when you attack a stronger party, you always get beaten.
There is some truth in that.
Then again, you make a point of never attacking an orphan.
Of course. We are orphans ourselves and know what it is like.
Yes, but the word has gotten around. So what happens? Everyone we capture says he's an orphan. The last three ships we took proved to be manned entirely by orphans, and so we had to let them go. One would think Great Britain's merchant navy was made up of only orphans, which we know is not the case.
But hang it all, you wouldn't have us entirely without mercy.
There's my problem. Until midnight, I would. After midnight, I wouldn't. What a delicate situation.
And Ruth, your own Ruth, whom you love so well, and who has won her middle-aged way into your boyish heart? What has become of her?
Oh, he'll take you with him.
Well, Ruth, I feel some little difficulty about you. It is true that I admire you very much, but I have been constantly at sea since I was 8 years old, and yours is the only woman's face I have seen during that time. I think it is a sweet face.
It is. Oh, it is.
I say, I think it is. But I have never had an opportunity to compare you with other women, and it is just possible I may be mistaken.
True.
What a terrible thing it would be if I were to marry this innocent person and then find out that she is on the whole plain.
Oh, Ruth is, well, Ruth is very well indeed.
Yes. There are the remains of a fine woman about Ruth.
Do you really think so?
I do.
Then I will not be selfish and take her from you. In justice to her and in consideration for you, I will leave her behind.
No, Frederick, this must not be. We are rough men who lead a rough life, but we are not so heartless as to deprive you of your love. I think there is not one here who would rob you of this treasure for anything in the world. No, I thought there wasn't. Keep your love, Frederick. Keep your love.
You were so very good to me.
Well, it's the top of the tide and we must be off. Farewell, Frederick. When you begin your extermination, let our deaths be as swift and painless as you can.
I will. By the love I have for you, I swear it. I wish that you could make this extermination unnecessary by coming with me back to civilization.
No, Frederick, it cannot be. I don't think much of our profession, but compared to respectable people, we are fairly honest. No, Frederick. I shall live and die a pirate king. Yeah. Oh, better far to live and die under the brave black flag I fly. And play a sanctimonious part with a pirate head and a pirate heart. Away to the cheating world go you, where pirates all are well to do. But I'll be true to the song I sing and live and die a pirate king. For I am a pirate king.
He is a rough the pirate king.
And it is a glorious thing to be a pirate king.
It is hurrah for the pirate king, hurrah for the pirate king.
When I sally forth to seek my prey, I help myself in a royal way. I sink a few more ships, it's true, than a well-bred monarch ought to do. But many a king on a first-class throne, if he wants to call his crown his own, must manage somehow to get through more dirty work than ever I do. For I am a pirate king. And it is a glorious thing to be a pirate king.
Hurrah for the pirate king!
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah. Oh, take me with you, master. I cannot live if I'm left behind.
Ruth, I will be quite honest with you. You're very dear to me, but I must be very careful. You see, you are considerably older than I. A lad of 21 usually looks for a wife of 17.
A wife of 17? You will find me a wife of 1,000.
No, but I shall find you a wife of 47, and that is quite enough. Ruth, tell me honestly and openly, compared with other women, how are you?
I will answer you truthfully, Master. I have a slight cold, but otherwise I am quite well.
I'm sorry for your cold, but I was referring to your personal appearance. Compared with other women, are you beautiful?
I have been told so, dear Master.
Ah, but lately?
No, years then. Years ago.
What do you think of yourself?
It is a delicate question to answer, but I think I am a fine woman.
That is your honest opinion?
Yes, I should be deceiving you if I told you otherwise.
Thank you, Ruth. I believe you. I am sure you would not take advantage of my lack of experience. I wish to do the right thing, and if, I say if, you really are a fine woman, your age shall not interfere with our marriage. Listen, I hear voices. Who has dared to come near our pirate den? Can it be the law? No, it doesn't sound like men.
Oh no, it is the voices of young girls. If he should see them, I am lost.
By all that is marvelous, a whole troop of beautiful maidens.
Lost, lost, lost!
How lovely, how lovely, how beautiful is the ugliest one. What grace, what delicacy, what refinement. And Ruth, Ruth told me she was beautiful.
Lovely spot. I wonder where we are. And I wonder where Papa is.
We have left him ever so far behind.
Oh, he will be here presently. And we have came over a rather difficult country.
But how delightful it is to be so entirely alone.
Probably we are the first human beings who set foot on this enchanting place.
Except the mermaids.
It's the very place for mermaids. Who are only human beings down to the waist.
And who can't be said strictly to set foot anywhere.
Tails, yes. Feet, no.
But what shall we do until Papa arrives?
We are quite alone.
And the sea is as smooth as glass.
Suppose we take off our shoes and stockings and paddle?
In the water!
Yes! Yes! Yes. The very thing!
Stop, ladies, stop!
Amen!
Forgive me for intruding, ladies, but it is my duty to inform you that you are being watched.
But sir, who are you?
I'm a pirate.
A pirate? Horror!
Ladies, do not put me to shame tonight. I am leaving this vile profession. And, oh, beautiful maidens, how my heart aches. I beg for your help.
How pitiful.
How handsome he is.
Is there one maiden among you who feels enough sense of duty to give up your ambitions of marrying a rich man to rescue me from my unfortunate position?
No, not one.
Is there not one maiden among you? It doesn't matter how homely your face is or how bad your complexion. If you will but look at me, I will love you forever.
No, not one.
Not one?
No, no, not one.
Not one?
Yes, one.
It's Mabel!
Oh, sisters, have you no pity? Shame, shame. True, he is a pirate, but is that enough reason for you to be deaf to his need for help?
The question is, if you were not so helpful,
would she be quite so willing to help?
So willing.
We must not lose our senses. Men who sick at no offenses will anon be here. Piracy, their dreadful trade is. Pray you get you hence, young ladies, while the coast is clear.
Here's your first great opportunity to get married with impunity and indulge in the felicity of unbounded domesticity. You shall quickly be personified, conjugally matrimonified by a doctor of divinity who is located in this vicinity. Doctor of Divinity, who resides in this vicinity, by a doctor of Divinity.
Monsters, before you try and wed us against our wills, you should know that we are wards of the court, and our father is a major general.
Yes, yes, I am a Major General. General.
It is hurrah for the Major General, hurrah for the Major General.
I am the very model of a modern Major General. I've information, vegetable, animal, and mineral. I know the kings of England and I quote the vice historical. From Marathon to Waterloo in order categorical. I'm very well acquainted too with matters mathematical. I understand equations both the simple and quadratical. About binomial theorem, I'm teeming with a lot of news. A lot of news. Many cheerful facts about the square of the hypotenuse.
Many cheerful facts about the square of the hypotenuse. Many cheerful facts about the square of the hypotenuse. Many cheerful facts about the square of the hypotenuse.
I'm very good at integral and differential calculus. I know the scientific names of beings and amalgams. In short, it matters vegetable, animal, and mineral. I am the very model of a modern Major General. And now that I've introduced myself, I should like to have some idea of what's going on here.
Oh, Papa, we...
Permit me. I'll explain in two words. We propose to marry your daughters.
Dear me!
Against our wills, Papa! Against our wills!
Oh, but you mustn't do that. I ask, this is a handsome uniform, but I'm not familiar with it. What are you?
We're all single gentlemen.
Yes, I gathered that. Anything else?
Nope, nothing else.
Papa, don't believe them. They are pirates, the famous Pirates of Penzance.
The Pirates of Penzance? I have often heard of them.
All except this gentleman, who was a pirate once, but who is out of his indentures today and intends to live a blameless life evermore.
But wait a bit. I object to pirates and sons-in-laws.
We object to Major Generals as fathers-in-law, but we will overlook that point.
Ha! An idea! And do you mean to say that you would deliberately rob me of these children and leave me to go through the rest of my life unfriended, unprotected, and alone?
Yep, that's the idea.
Tell me, have you ever known what it is like to be an orphan?
Here we go again.
I ask you, have you ever known what it is like to be an orphan?
Often.
Yes, orphan. Have you ever known what it is like to be one?
I say, often.
Often, often, often!
I don't think we quite understand one another. I ask you, have you ever known what it is like to be an orphan? And you say, orphan. Oh, I see. You are merely repeating the word orphan to show that you do not understand me.
I didn't repeat the word often.
Pardon me, you did indeed.
I only repeated it once.
True, but you repeated it.
But not often.
Stop! I think I could see where we're all getting confused. When you said orphan, did you mean orphan, a person who has lost his parents, or often, frequently?
I see what you mean. Frequently.
Ah, you said often, frequently.
No, only once.
Exactly. You said often, frequently, only once.
Oh,
men of dark and dismal fate, have pity on my lonely state. I am an orphan boy.
An orphan boy?
An orphan boy.
How sad. An orphan boy.
These children here are all that I can call my own.
Poor fellow!
If you take them away from me, I shall be alone indeed. If you can feel any pity, then leave them with me. Can you harden your hearts against the sad story of a lonely orphan boy?
Poor fellow!
I am telling a terrible story, but they were going to take my daughters over the billowy waters, and it's not the same as telling a regular terrible story.
Although our career sometimes involves us in crimes of stealing, we still have feelings. When there is trouble, we're always sorry to be the ones to start it. You are all free to go. Our pirate rules will protect you. The Major General will be an honorary member of our band. Yeah!
Hurrah for the orphan boy.
And it sometimes is a useful thing to be an orphan boy.
It is hurrah for the orphan boy. Hurrah for the orphan boy.
Happy day with joyous glee, we will away and married be.
Oh, happy day with joyous glee, we will away and married be.
Should it befall us spaciously, her sisters all will bridesmaids be.
Should it befall us spaciously, her sisters all will bridesmaids be. Oh, happy day with joyous glee, we will away and married be. Should it befall us spaciously, her sisters all will bridesmaids be.
Master, I beg you, remember your Ruth.
You deceived me.
You deceived him.
Do not leave me.
Do not leave her.
You grieve me.
You grieve him.
I wish you'd leave me.
We wish you'd leave him.
This is intermission, and I'd like to invite Sue Klunk up to the stage. She is our Berkley Choir Booster president, and she's here to say a few words.
Good evening, everyone. Happy to be here today. And first of all, I want to congratulate our Anderson choirs and directors on a wonderful year and on a wonderful first act on the Boosters. We're very proud to have contributed some part of this wonderful evening. And before I actually go any farther, I'm also supposed to remind you of the popcorn also, because the Mystic Kettle people give a nice percentage to the choir boosters. So please don't let them leave without any popcorn. So what is Boosters? Well, our Boosters are really all of you. You're all part of the Boosters, and we have really been fortunate with wonderful financial and volunteer support this year. So we want to thank all of you. I've had a chance to meet a number of people over the course of the year, and we really thank you for that. We've had no trouble, you know, getting volunteers. It's really been a smooth and exciting year, and we feel like we've been able to, you know, meet some of the goals we had for this year, which was to add some enrichment. I know some of your kids went to the opera a couple of weeks ago. Yeah, it was wonderful. I was fortunate to get to join them for a fabulous, and I couldn't believe what was going on downtown these days. So it was a really wonderful experience, both the opera and getting downtown with the students, as well as just, you know, adding, I guess, a little more icing to things, our middle school parties that we had last year, and just, you know, more food and snacks on the festival trips, just, you know, things to really, you know, engage them and help everybody enjoy themselves. We handed out a sheet with the programs, which lists some of the highlights of the year, so hopefully you'll take a few moments to look at that, as well as some shout-outs to some of our most active volunteers this year, as well as our executive committee. And we have some open positions next year, so those of you who might want to get a little bit more involved, my information is there. It's a nice group. We have a lot of fun. It's not overly a commitment. We are looking to fill some positions, vice president, secretary, treasurer, and then also we're in the works of creating positions that are specifically for a NORP representative and Anderson representative, so someone who really is a liaison working with Julie, working with our choir board, and really making sure the needs and interests of the program in Anderson are met. I want to thank, one of the things we started this year, is as some of our parents are moving on to a new school, just like our eighth graders are, and our at the high school, our seniors that were moving on, we wanted to recognize particular volunteers who had really been really engaged with our choir program and added a lot of value and energy over these years. So I want to do that right now. So if Amy Federhoff is in the audience somewhere, I haven't seen you today, but I'm assuming you're here. Anyway, one of the benefits of Sign Up Genius is you can really go back and see who's been around all the time. And when I go back the last few years, somebody's name comes up for fundraisers and for festivals and for chaperoning all over the board. And this year, she joined our board this year and ran our biggest fundraiser of the year, Century Resources. So that has enormous impact on our program. So we want to take the time to recognize her and, you know, make sure she sticks with it as she moves into high school. So we have alternative motivation. So. And last, we want to give a special thank you to our choir directors, Ty Kimmler. Ty, I'm assuming, is here somewhere. Oh, all right. Ty Kimmerly, who came in this year and has really been dedicated to the group at the time she's there. She comes to our meetings and gives her input, and has really been a pleasure to get to know this year. So I'll have to get this to you later, as well as our director for 6th and 8th grade, Julie Smith. We want to thank her, too, for all the work she does with our students and the inspiration and ideas. So. Thank you all again. I look forward to meeting you and working with you over the coming year, and enjoy the rest of the show.
Frederick, in your excellent wisdom, cannot you say something that will relieve my father's sorrow?
I will try, dear Mabel, but why does he sit here night after night in this drafty old ruin?
Why do I sit here? To escape from the pirates! I told them I was an orphan, and, heaven help me, I am no orphan! I came here to humble myself before the tombs of my ancestors, and to beg their pardon for having brought dishonor to the family name.
Be comforted, sir. Had you not acted as you did, those reckless men would surely have called in the nearest clergyman and married your large family on the spot.
Thank you, Frederick, but it is no use. Such anguish and remorse I feel at the terrible lie I told those stupid pirates, that I would go to their simple-minded chief this very night and confess it all if I did not fear that the results would be most disastrous to myself. At what time does your expedition march against those scoundrels?
At 11. And before midnight, I hope to make up for my accidental association with the slimy vermin by sweeping them from the face of the earth. And then, dear Mabel, you will be mine.
Are your devoted followers at hand?
They are. They only wait for my orders.
Then let them appear to receive a general's blessing before they depart on their dreadful adventure.
When the foeman bears the steel, to run, to run, to run, to rock, we uncomfortable feel to run, to rock. And we find the wisest thing to run, to run, to run, to rock, is to slap our chest and sing to run, to rock.
Thank you.
you don't go. Yes, but you don't go.
Calls.
Your late commander.
And your little Ruth.
You mad intruders, how dare you face me? Don't you remember that I've doomed you to your extermination?
Have mercy on us.
Before you slaughter us.
I do not think I ought to listen to you, but I will be merciful. Say on.
When you had left our pirate fold, we tried to raise our spirits faint according to our custom old with quips and quibbles quaint. But all in vain the quips we heard, we lay and sobbed upon the rock until to somebody occurred a startling paradox.
A paradox.
A paradox, a most ingenious paradox. With quips and quibbles heard and thoughts, but none to beat this paradox. A paradox, a paradox, a most ingenious paradox. A ha 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 ha, this paradox.
We knew your taste for curious quips, for cranks and contradictions queer, and with the laughter on our lips, we wish you there to hear. We said if we could tell it him, how Frederick would the joke enjoy, and so we risked both life and limb to tell it to our boy.
A paradox.
A paradox, a most ingenious paradox. With quips and quibbles heard in flocks, but none to beat this paradox.
A paradox, a paradox, a most ingenious paradox. Ha 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 ha, this paradox.
For some ridiculous reason, somebody decided that in the beastly month of February, 28 days are usually enough, except one in every four, there are 29 days. You are the victim of this clumsy arrangement, having been born on the 29th of February. So, by simple arithmetic, you'll see that, although you've lived 21 years, yet, by going by birthdays, you're only 5 and a little bit over.
Dear me, let's see. Yes, my figures agree with yours.
How quaint the ways of paradox, and common sense it gaily mocks. Though counting in the usual way, years 21 I've been alive. Yet reckoning by my natal day, yet reckoning by my natal day.
1, 2, 3, 4. I am a little boy of 5.
Yes, a little boy of 5. A paradox, a paradox, a most ingenious paradox. Ha 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 ha. This paradox. Ha 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 ha. A curious paradox. Ha 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 ha. A most ingenious paradox.
You're 5.
Upon my word, this is most curious. 5 years old? No one would think it to look at me.
I think you were glad now that you did not kill us. You would have never forgiven yourself when you had discovered you had killed two of your comrades.
My comrades?
I'm afraid you don't understand your position. You were apprenticed to us.
Until I reached my 21st year.
No, until you reached your 21st birthday. And by going by birthdays, you're only 5 1/4.
You don't mean you're going to hold me to that?
No. We merely remind you of the fact and leave the rest to your sense of duty.
Your sense of duty.
Well, you have appealed to my sense of duty, and my duty is all too clear. I despise your piracy. I shiver at the thought that I was ever a part of it. But my duty comes first. At any price, I will do my duty.
Bravely spoken. Come, you're one of us once more.
Lead on. I follow. Oh, hang it all.
What's the matter?
Should I tell you? No, I cannot do it. And yet, as one of your band...
Speak out, I charge you, by your sense of duty.
General Stanley, the father of my Mabel...
Yes?
He escaped from you on the plea that he was an orphan.
He did? Oh, yes he did.
It breaks my heart to betray the honored father of the girl I adore, but as your apprentice, I have no choice. It is my duty to tell you that General Stanley is no orphan.
What?
More than that, he never was one.
Am I to understand that to save his rotten life, he dared to deceive us? Our revenge shall be swift and terrible. We will go and get our band and attack Stanley's castle this very night.
But wait.
Not a word. He is doomed.
All is prepared, Frederick. Your gallant crew await you. What's this? My Frederick in tears? Can it be that your heart trembles in fear of the coming conflict?
No, Mabel, no. A terrible fact has been revealed to me. Mabel, my loved one, I bound myself to serve a pirate captain until I reach my 21st birthday.
But you are 21.
I've just discovered that I was born in leap year, and I will not reach that birthday for 60 years more.
Oh, horrible!
And so, farewell.
No, oh, Frederick, hear me. Stay here. They have no legal claim on you. No shame will fall on you if you stay.
No, Mabel, no. Tonight, I must leave. It is my duty to return. I must obey. In 60 years more, I shall be of age. I'll return and then claim you.
It seems so long.
Swear that. Till then, you will be true to me.
Yes, I'll be strong. By all the Stanleys dead and gone, I swear it.
And I will be faithful to you till we are wed.
Till we are wed.
And even after.
Come, all of you. This affair is now coming to a crisis. No matter, he will not lead you. He has returned to the pirates.
He has acted shamefully.
That is not so. You know nothing about it. He acted nobly.
He has acted nobly.
He has made a heroic sacrifice to his sense of duty. If it was his duty to make himself my enemy, it is then my duty to regard him as my enemy. He has done his duty. I will do mine. And you, go and do yours.
Right. This is perplexing. No matter. Our course is clear. We must do our best to capture these pirates alone. It is most distressing that we should be the ones to take away their precious freedom. But we should have thought of that before we joined the force.
We should.
It is too late now. Maturing his felonious little plans. His capacity for innocent enjoyment. Is just as great as any honest man's. Our feelings we with difficulty smother. One constabulary duties to be done. I take one consideration with another. A policeman's lot is not a happy one. Constabulary duties to be done.
prison. Burglar's not a burglar.
Not a burglar.
When the cutthroat isn't occupied in crime.
Hiding crime.
He loves to hear the little brook a-gurgling, and listen to the merry village chime.
Village chime.
When the coster's finished jumping on his mother,
on his mother,
he loves to lie a-basking in the sun.
In the sun.
I take one consideration with another.
With another.
A policeman's lot is not a happy one.
A rollicking band of pirates we, who tired of tossing on the sea, are trying their hand at a burglary with weapons grim and gory. A rollicking band of pirates we, who tired of tossing on the sea, are trying their hand at a burglary with weapons grim and gory. We are now coming for silver or gold, the story General Stanley told. We seek a penalty 50-fold for General Stanley's story.
Not a word. I see a light inside. Hide quickly. The Major General's coming.
Yes, yes, the Major General's coming.
Yes, yes, the Major General's coming.
Yes, yes, the Major General's coming. My conscience aches because of the terrible story I told. No peace, no sleep, and as I lay in bed, I thought I heard a noise.
He thought he heard a noise.
Ha, ha, ha. No, all is still. My mind is set at ease. It must have been the wind.
It must have been the
wind. Oh, Papa, now what is this?
Why does Father leave his rest? At such a time of night as this, so very incompletely dressed,
what strange thing could have happened?
To call Father from his rest. At such a time of night as this, so very incompletely dressed?
Forward, my men, and seize that general there. His life is over.
Frederick, you're here. Oh joy. Call forth your men and capture these pirates.
Frederick, save us.
Mabel, I would if I could, but I can't.
He's telling the truth. He can't save you.
You deceived us. You made us feel sorry for you. Our revenge is sweet. Gather your courage and prepare for death, General Stanley.
Is he to die with no one to defend him? Is there no one with a weapon to defend him?
Oh, spare him!
Oh, help!
Yes, we are here!
Oh, master!
You will yield!
Oh, rapture!
We triumph now. Your mortal career is cut short. Our pirate band will never be taken by you.
You have the advantage now, but your proud triumph will not last long.
Don't say you're orphans. We know that game.
No, no. We have a stronger claim on you. We ask you to surrender in the name of Queen Victoria.
You do?
We do.
We ask you to surrender in the name of Queen Victoria.
We humble ourselves and surrender at once. In spite of all of our faults, we love our queen.
Yes, with all their faults, they love their queen.
Yes, with all their faults.
Yes, with all their faults, they love our queen.
Take them away, at once!
Wait one moment. Let me tell you who they are. They are not common criminals. They are all noble gentlemen who have gone wrong.
I'm overwhelmed. I ask you to pardon me, ex-pirate king, and I will pardon you. Go back to your regular duties, and take my daughters. They are all beauties.
Oh, happy day, we joyously, we will.